When you throw people out, very quickly, the house starts to get wasted.
And this, of course, affects these midterm elections. If President Obama cares about Democrats controlling the House and the Senate, this is the major issue, is the economy, jobs, foreclosures. And yet, they constantly, just in the last few days, David Axelrod, the White House adviser speaking for the president, says they're in fact valid foreclosures that probably should go forward. HUD, they're saying the same thing. Where do people gain any confidence that the president, who said he was taking on the big corporations, cares more about them than the banks?
Well, you know, one of the key words here that you said is valid foreclosures, because we believe we have a system of the rule of law. But what we have to recognize is that there was fraud all along the line. They were creating these mortgages at such a rate that the documentation wasn't done well. That we know there are lots of instances where when the people went into the final signing of the mortgages, the income that was stated was not the income that the person told them. And then they would say something, oh, don't worry, that's a technical detail. So is that a valid mortgage or not? The fact was, it looks like the documentation was right, but in the creation of the documentation, there was fraud. Now, we were manufacturing, or the financial sector was manufacturing, bad mortgages at such a rate that literally it's extraordinarily difficult to tell at this juncture what is a good mortgage and what was not. When there was misrepresentation to the borrower, is that valid or not? And so I think we have to recognize that this process from 2003, 2004 on, was just rife with these problems. And it allowed the banks to book high profits then. And now the key issue is they don't want to admit the losses that are associated. And that's really what the battle is about.
We're talking to Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel Prize-winning economist, professor at Columbia University. His book is just out in paperback. It's called Free Fall, America, Free Markets, and the Sinking of the World Economy. If you want to join into the discussion, you can send in your questions at Facebook, facebook.com/democracynow. We'll be back in a minute. Nothing from nothing. Billy Preston here on Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. We're broadcasting over 900 stations on Pacifica and NPR and college and community stations, public access TV and PBS TV stations, and both TV satellite networks, Dish Network, Channel 9415, Free Speech TV, 9410, Link TV, Direct TV, Channel 375, and 348. And we are—our headlines are also available in Spanish for radio stations to take us over 250 R. I'm Amy Goodman. Our guest is Joseph Stiglitz, Nobel Prize-winning economist, professor at Columbia University. His book is out in paperback, Free Fall, America, Free Markets, and the Sinking of the World Economy. So just to summarize, you are for a national moratorium on foreclosures.
I think inevitably—I think we have to be moving towards that. And the reason is very simple. There were such bad practices were so rife, the inequities were so rife, the fraudulent behavior was so common, that at this point we don't know what is a valid mortgage and not. And the consequences of throwing somebody out of their home when they shouldn't be are hard to reverse. I mean, just imagine what it does to the family. The education of their kids are interrupted, what it does to the community. So when we have to balance the injustices, and life is unfortunately always balancing one side versus the other, and where will their mistakes be easily reversed and where not? My view is if we keep them in the homes for a little longer, they owe them money. They still owe them money. That doesn't let them off the hook. But what we're saying is we're not going to speed up this process of where there's a serious risk of an inequity that will not be easily compensated for.
Joe Stiglitz, the deficit, the battle cry of the Tea Party movement, of the Republicans as well. Robert Rubin has weighed in, says any new stimulus plan is highly likely to be counterproductive. What do you think has to happen? Does the deficit matter, and how do you think it should be dealt with?
My view is we cannot afford not to stimulate the economy. So anybody that says we should go back to austerity or we should not have a second round stimulus just doesn't understand economics. And let me be very clear about this. If we don't stimulate the economy is going to get weaker. When the economy gets weaker, tax revenues go down and expenditures go up. Already, more than 40 million Americans are on food stamps. Number of people on Medicaid is reaching record levels. So revenues go down, expenditures go up, deficits get worse. If you stimulate the economy, then people get jobs, they spend money, revenue, tax revenues go up. Now, if we spend the money on investments, investments in education, technology, infrastructure, you grow the economy in the short run from the stimulus, you grow the economy in the long term because of the returns that you get on these investments. I mean, just think about this as from the point of view of a firm. If you were a firm and you could borrow at 0 to 2.5%, which is what the government can borrow, and you have investment opportunities that yield 10, 15, 20%, you would be irresponsible. You would be foolish not to undertake those investments. So anybody that says, I'm going to only look at one side of the balance sheet, the liabilities, I'm not going to look at the other side, the assets, is really not understanding economics. It's that kind of reasoning that got our country in the trouble in the first place. The people who didn't, short-sighted behavior of the banks that got our country in trouble in the first place. And to me, I just view those kinds of statements as totally irresponsible.
Let me ask you how war fits into this. I mean, you co-wrote the book with Linda Bilmes, The $3 Trillion War. How does war fit into our problems with the economy?
Well, war fits in because you're creating a liability. You're spending money. And when we went to a war in Iraq and Afghanistan, we already had a deficit. And so these wars were the first wars in America's history financed totally on the credit card. So you're creating a liability, but you're not creating an asset. So that's the kind of spending that does weaken the economy because it's one-sided. Now, we came out just a couple weeks ago with new numbers that unfortunately show that our old numbers were a little wrong in the sense that they were too conservative.
$3 trillion.
Was too little. And particularly what we looked at in a report we testified before Congress, what we looked at was the large number of troops returning who are disabled. Turned out that the numbers returning disabled are higher than we had estimated. It's close to 50% now. And the cost per disabled, injured troop is higher. So we had talked then about the cost of health care and disability payments for our returning troops, and the order made a little less than $500 billion. That's a lot of money. Our new numbers, our best estimate, in excess of $900 billion. These are unfunded liabilities, a moral obligation. They fought for us.